Hello kids, Shubhamangalam. I'm a little scholar, myself Sridip. I'll be taking up class 10th physics for today. And we were on chapter number 2. We were solving equations. We were learning how to balance equations. And we were learning different symbols and formulae for many of the equations. So by now you must have understood that why are we studying chemical equations? Why are we studying the symbols and formulae? Is it so easy to write them in words? Is it easy to write calcium oxide plus water reacts with water and gives you calcium hydroxide all the time? For every other equation, for every other chemical reaction, if I start writing in words, it's going to take me days and days. So what was an easy way? The easiest way was to use symbols and formulae. When you're using symbols and formulae, also you need to show that you're proving the law of conservation of mass. What is the law of conservation of mass? Mass of the reactants should be equal to mass of the products. Okay, this means mass of the substances on the left-hand side should be equal to the mass of the substances on the right-hand side. For example, carbon reacts with oxygen gives you carbon dioxide. The mass of carbon and oxygen together should be equal to mass of carbon dioxide. Only then the law of conservation of mass is going to be proved. Yes or no? So now we are going to study further how to find out various other substances when one quantity is given, like a mass-mass relationship and so on. Before that, I want you to open up your textbooks and turn to page number 23. We have a think and write that we have to discuss, which I didn't discuss in the last video, but I will discuss it now. I thought to discuss it at the end of the chapter, but because we know right now how to balance equations, I think this will be very easier for you this right now. So page number 23 class, I want you to open up to think and write. You have brushed the wall with an aqueous solution of calcium hydroxide. What is aqueous? Solid plus liquid. Remember that, okay? You have brushed the wall with an aqueous suspension of calcium hydroxide. After 2 days, the wall turned to white color. Write the balanced chemical reaction for the above changes using the appropriate symbols and formulae. So they have given you the formula of calcium hydroxide, by the way. Okay, calcium hydroxide is also called as slaked lime. S-L-A-K-E-D, slaked lime. Okay, how is calcium hydroxide formed when calcium oxide reacts with water? The very first thing that we studied in our chapter. Okay, calcium oxide plus water gives you calcium hydroxide. What is calcium oxide also called as? It is called as quicklime. Whereas calcium hydroxide is also called as slaked lime. Okay, so what are they telling? That if you are painting your walls with a suspension of calcium hydroxide, after a certain amount of time, it got hardened. Do you remember how is whitewashing done? They are going to, you know, paint your walls with a certain amount of liquid. That is nothing but called as whitewashing. But what is happening after you are painting your walls with the white color? After some time it hardens, yes or no? Why does it harden? Because the calcium hydroxide suspension or the calcium hydroxide, solution is going to react with the carbon dioxide present in the atmosphere. Okay, calcium hydroxide is going to react with the carbon dioxide present in the atmosphere and it is going to give you calcium carbonate plus water. What is this calcium carbonate? It is nothing but the whitewash on the walls. Do you understand? Okay, if you assign a job to somebody to whitewash the walls of your house, he's going to come, he's going to check where all to whitewash, then he's going to prepare a solution of whitewash. Yes or no? That solution of whitewash that he is going to, add up on the floor is nothing but calcium hydroxide. So he is going to paint the walls one by one by using that suspension, by using that solution. And after some time, he says you to wait for some time, for just a few hours or few days. So what is going to happen in that span of time? That calcium hydroxide which has been painted on the walls is going to react with the carbon dioxide present in the air around the walls. Do you understand? Air is nothing but, it is a composure of all these gases. So how much of a carbon dioxide was present in the air around the walls, that is going to react with the calcium hydroxide on the walls, and the walls solution on the walls is going to get hardened up. Okay, it is going to get hardened. So once the solution is hardened, after it has reacted with the air around, or after it has reacted with the surrounding air, it is nothing but the calcium carbonate deposit on the walls right now. So whatever you see right now on the walls, on the whitewashed walls of yours, it is nothing but the calcium carbonate deposit. Okay, the calcium carbonate is nothing but the whitewash. Okay, it is a solid deposit on the walls, and whatever is left out is nothing but the water vapor on the walls that will be dried up within, you know, some hours or a few days. If you're leaving it in a spacious room, if you're leaving the fans on and all, the water vapor on the calcium carbonate walls is going to deposit. Okay, I hope you have understood. If this was your wall and you painted it with calcium hydroxide solution, okay, after some time it is going to get deposited like a white solid. Like white solid is nothing but calcium carbonate, and it will have few droplets of water on it, which is nothing but the residual water which was left out after the reaction happened. Okay, so you're going to write this particular reaction over here on page number 23. Also, if you want to check whether it is balanced or not, can you see just one calcium and one calcium over here? It is two hydrogen and two oxygen. Can we see that? Let's take hydrogen first. Hydrogen is 2. Hydrogen is 2 on the right hand side also. Oxygen is 2 here. Oxygen is 2 here. So totally there are 4 oxygen atoms on the left hand side. Look at the right hand side. There are 3 oxygen atoms plus 1 oxygen atom. Again 4. Oxygen also balanced. Carbon 1, carbon 1. Carbon is also balanced. Note down the equation. Try to check whether it is balanced or not. It is actually balanced. I've already told you. Please note down the equation. If you want me to write it much more neatly for you, I will do that again so that it is much more clearer this time. I will write out the equation. Okay, so as per the question, what are you painting on the walls? What are you brushing on the walls? You are brushing calcium hydroxide. What is this calcium hydroxide? What is going to happen to this calcium hydroxide once you have brushed this particular solution on the walls? It is going to react with carbon dioxide. And after this, what is going to happen? It is going to form a deposit on the walls. What is that deposit called as? The whitewash? Nothing but calcium carbonate. Okay, plus H2O, the residual amount of water. Okay. That's the equation. Please note it down. So class, I want you to open up your textbooks. Okay, we are done till page number 27 and also a part of 28. We have discussed how to make the information, how to make the equation informative. There are 4 characteristics that you need to remember. One is expressing the physical state, whether it is solid, liquid, gas or aqueous. The other is to express whether a gas is evolved or not with the help of an upward arrow. Next, precipitate is evolved or not with the help of downward arrow. Expressing the heat changes, whether it is an exothermic or an endothermic reaction. Now I want you to come to page number 28. Okay, there are some important points that we need to discuss together here. Page number 28 class, the subheading is interpreting a balanced chemical equation. What do you mean by interpreting? Understanding what is there in a balanced chemical equation. Okay, so the first one, a chemical equation gives information about the reactants and products through their symbols and formulae. Yes or no? If I write a basic water equation on the board like H2 plus O2 giving you H2O, and let's balance it. What do you understand by writing this chemical equation on the board? You understand that hydrogen is reacting with oxygen to give you water. You get some basic information with the help of the symbols and formulae over here. Let's look at the second point. It gives the ratio of molecules of reactants and products. What would be the ratio of molecules over here? It is 2 molecules of hydrogen reacting with 1 molecule of oxygen and giving you 2 molecules of water. Yes or no? This is how you know how many molecules of that particular substance have been involved to give you the product. Do you understand? So the third one, as molecular masses are expressed in unified masses, the relative masses of reactants and products are known from the equation. Now the mass of hydrogen is 1 gram. Okay, mass of oxygen is 16 grams. this gram can also be written as capital U, can also be represented as capital U. What is U over here? U is nothing but unified mass. Okay. It is just one another way of expressing the weight of the substance or the mass of the substance. Okay, instead of using gram, we might be using capital U over here, and U is nothing but unified mass. The name itself tells you it is going to tell you, it is going to denote the mass of the substance involved as reactants and as products. So for example, if hydrogen mass was 2, then look at the subscript over here, it is 2. Into the mass of hydrogen is given as how much? 1 grams. So 2 into 1. How did this 2 come then? It is nothing but the coefficient 2. Did you understand? Okay, it is 2H2 plus. The mass of hydrogen is 1 gram. Do you understand? The mass of hydrogen is 1 gram. Subscript given over here is 2. So 2 into 1. This 1 here is nothing but the mass of 1 hydrogen atom. Okay, that I put in brackets. And how did this 2 come? This is nothing but the coefficient. Let's look at for oxygen. What is the coefficient over here? It is nothing. It is 1, right? So just writing 1 is also no use, because 1 into anything is going to be the same number. Okay, now the mass of oxygen is how much class? 16. And what is the subscript over here? 2. So 2 into 16. Do you understand? Like this. So 2 into 2 is nothing but 4. So 16 twos are 32. Do you get this? It is somewhat like this. Fine. Okay. So now, where were we? Yes, we were in the fourth one. If the masses are expressed in grams, then the equation also gives the molar ratios of reactants and products. If the gases are involved, we can equate their masses to their volumes and calculate the volumes or those gases liberated at given condition of temperature and pressure using molar mass and molar volume relationship. There is a certain thing that you need to remember, like 1 mole of gas at any STP, 1 mole of gas at standard temperature and pressure is going to have 22.4 liters of volume and Avogadro number of molecules. You need to remember this notion over here, that 1 mole of any gas at STP is going to have 22.4 liters of volume and Avogadro number of molecules. Okay, so now the next part that we need to deal over here is, yes, they are mentioning about the molar mass and Avogadro number. Using molar mass and Avogadro number, we can calculate the number of molecules and atoms of different substances. We will know this once we are doing the problems. So there are, you know, four types of information that you can get from certain relationships over here. It is mass to mass in relationship, mass to volume relationship, volume-volume relationship, mass, volume and number of molecules. Don't confuse yourself by looking at so many, you know, terminologies over here. This was just a rough check of what all things are we going to study in the further upcoming problems over here. So for now, we will be doing the problems one by one, and I hope you will understand them. So class, I want you to turn to page number 28 for the first problem. Okay, it is a very simple chemical equation that we had already balanced in the previous video. It is nothing but aluminium reacting with iron oxide and giving you aluminium trioxide and iron. Okay, so the equation is given on page number 28 as example number 1. So let me note down the equation. It is aluminium reacting with ferric oxide or iron oxide over here and giving you aluminium trioxide and giving you aluminium trioxide plus iron over here. Okay, so that is what it is. Fine. So aluminium plus iron oxide giving you aluminium trioxide and iron. So that is the equation given to us. We need to check whether it is balanced or not. Is it balanced? No. We have 1 aluminium over here and 2 aluminium over here. We have balanced this chemical equation in the previous video. It was given as one of the examples for balancing the chemical equations. So you need to put a 2 over here and you need to put a 2 over here, and then it is balanced. They have also given us the individual masses of the elements over here. So aluminium is how much? 27 grams. Remember, grams will be replaced as unified mass over here. So let us note down, aluminium is 27 unified mass or U. Ferrous or iron is 56 unified mass. And oxygen is, as I told you in the example that when I was explaining you about interpreting the balance equation, it is 16 unified mass. Okay, let's have a clear indication over here. What are we talking about? Fine, we have a chemical equation, and once a chemical equation is given to us, we need to check whether it is balanced or not. Then, if it is balanced, well and good, we will continue with the rest of the problem. If it is not balanced, we try to balance it first. So once we are balancing it, after balancing, we are going to note down the masses of the individual substances over here which are involved. Aluminium, iron and oxygen, these are the elements which are involved, and I've written the mass of every substance over here. Now what am I going to do? I'm going to calculate the mass. Look at this, 2 into, what was the mass of aluminium given in the question? It is given as 2. It is given as 27, but the coefficient given here is 2. Do you understand? I want to calculate the mass of this whole substance over here. Mass of aluminium is given, but twice of that will be how much? I need to write like that. So mass of aluminium is given in the question, it is 27, and 2 is the coefficient. So to calculate the mass of this entire substance, I will be writing it as 2 into 27 plus. Okay, now let's look at this. How much is ferrous given as? 56. So, and what is the subscript over here? 2. So 2 into 56. Okay, now this entire compound over here involves two elements. It involves iron as well as oxygen. So whenever there is an involvement of two elements to form one big compound, you put a plus in the middle, because we also need to consider oxygen over here. We have already considered iron, now we need to consider oxygen also. Do you understand? So when we have considered iron over here, and we are about to consider oxygen, before that we need to put a plus sign. Okay, so what is the subscript of O over here? It is 3. Into, what is the mass of oxygen given as? 16. Okay, that is how you do it. Now, next, just like how you did for iron oxide, the same thing you need to repeat it for aluminium trioxide also over here. Let's try it out. Okay, so what is the subscript of aluminium given as? 2. And what is the mass of aluminium given in the question as? 27. So 2 into 27. There is one more element over here in the entire compound, and what is it? It is oxygen. So before writing about oxygen, I need to mention a plus sign. And what is the mass of oxygen over here? It is 16. So what is the subscript of oxygen? It is 3. So 3 into 16, that is how you write it, plus 2 into, what is the mass of ferrous given class? It is 56. So 2 into 56. What are we writing? We are writing the masses of the reactants and the products over here. Okay, 2 into 27 is how much? It is 54. And what was the unit over here? Capital U, which is nothing but unified mass. Okay, 2 into 56 is 112. 112 plus 16 into 3 is 48. Okay, now next part. 2 into 27 is 54. 54 plus 48 plus 2 into 56 is how much class? It is 112 U. Okay, the brackets one, we still need to solve them. It is 54 U plus 112 plus 48 is how much? 112 plus 48, 8 plus 2 is 10, 4 plus 1, 5, 6, it is 160. Okay, it is 160 U. Giving rise to how much? 54 plus 48. It is 8 plus 4 is nothing but 12. 5, 4, 9, 10. 102. 102, and the units are capital U unified mass plus 112 U. Okay, this is what you need to note down. So class, this was the, you know, solution that we found out for the equation over here. We had the equation given, we were given the individual masses, and we, you know, calculated the masses of the compounds, like calculated the mass of the reactants and the products respectively over here. And that is what we got in the last equation. The capital U represents as unified mass. I told you it is nothing but replacing grams. So this can also be written as 54 grams. Plus 160 grams giving rise to 102 grams plus 112 grams. Okay, instead of this, you can also write something else. Look at the coefficient over here. It is 2 aluminium. This means 2 molecules of aluminium or 2 moles of aluminium are participating in this particular chemical reaction. So if I see the coefficient 2 over here, I can write 2 moles of aluminium plus how many moles of iron oxide? Just 1, because what is the coefficient over here? It is 1. If there is no coefficient, it means just 1, okay? So it is 1 mole of iron oxide participating in the chemical reaction as a reactant and giving rise to 1 mole of aluminium trioxide plus 2 moles of iron. Do you understand? So the unified mass is nothing but representing the grams or the mass of the particular substance, either it is reactant or product. And also you can write it in the form of moles, which is by looking at the coefficient in the reactants as well as products respectively. Do you understand? If you want to write in the form of unified mass, you can do that. If you can write it in the form of grams, you can do that. You can also write it in the form of expressing it in moles by looking at the coefficients in the reactants and the products. So now let's move on to the actual question given to us. Okay, you have to come to page number 29 for this. Suppose that you are asked to calculate the amount of aluminium required to get 1120 kgs of iron by the above reaction. Okay, suppose that you are asked to calculate the amount of aluminium. They are asking you how much aluminium is required to get 1120 kgs of iron. To get 1120 kgs of iron. So which are the two substances in question over here? It is aluminium and it is iron, which is in question. Do you understand? So, as per this balance equation, how much aluminium was required for this much ferrous over here? It was 54 grams of aluminium required to get how much amount of iron? It is 112 grams of iron. Did you understand? As per the balance equation that you and I did it, which was given in the question, with the help of all the individual masses given in the question also, once we have calculated everything, as per the given, you know, equation, as per the given chemical equation over here, how much aluminium was required to get us this amount of iron over here? It was 54 grams of aluminium needed to get 112 grams of iron. But in the question they are asking us, if this is so, then how much amount of aluminium is required to get 1120 kg of iron? Do you understand? Okay, once they have given you the chemical equation, they are expecting you to balance it. And once you are done balancing it, they are expecting you to calculate the individual masses of the reactants and the products so that you can understand how much mass of the reactant was involved to get how much amount of product. So how much amount, so what is the question over here? Which two chemicals are there in the question? It is aluminium and iron. So let's consider just aluminium and iron in our chemical reaction, in a balanced chemical reaction over here. How much aluminium was required to get 112 grams of iron over here? It was 54 grams of aluminium required to get 112 grams of iron. Okay, we know this, but we don't know the question. What is the question over here? How much aluminium is required to get 1120 kg of iron? Did you understand now? This part is already given in the question. We were the ones to solve it. This part is something that you need to find out. Now the question mark here can be represented as what class? It can be represented as X, and I can cross multiply this. Okay, so all of us know that 1 kg is equal to 1000 grams. 1120 kg can be written as 1120 into 1000. So let's look at this. X, when I cross multiplies, X into 112 gives me how much class? 54 into 1120. Should I mention kgs only? No, I should mention it in grams. So 1120 into how many grams? 1000. So x is equal to 54 into 1120 into 1000 divided by 112. So 112 ones are, and here tens are. Okay, so totally how many zeros do I have over here? I have 54 and 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 zeros. Can I write this as 540 into 1000? All of us know 1 kg is 1000 grams. So this is nothing but 540 kgs. So what did you understand from this answer over here? If we require 54 grams of aluminium to give rise to 112 grams of iron, how much aluminium is required for 1120? It is 540 kgs of aluminium required to get 1120 kg of iron. Okay with everybody? So let's wind up. Let's recall how much did we study. We have a chemical equation over here. They gave us an unbalanced equation. What was the first step we did? We balanced it. After balancing it, we calculated the individual masses. Okay. After calculating the individual masses, we expressed it in unified mass, also in grams as well as in moles. Okay. So now after this, we read the actual question. What was the actual question? Suppose that you are asked to calculate the amount of aluminium. So what are they asking? What to calculate? They are asking us to calculate the amount of aluminium. Remember this part. One part of the question is already solved over here. What is in question? What are they asking us to solve? What are they asking us to calculate? They are asking us to find out the amount of aluminium to get 1120 kg of iron. How much iron have they mentioned? 1120. Now look at the question. Look at only aluminium and iron over here. How much aluminium was required to get 112 grams of iron over here? It was 54 grams of iron required to get 112 grams of iron over here. So in the question, they're asking us how much aluminium is required to get 1120 kgs of iron. Now kgs can be converted, should be converted into grams, because the rest of the other two units are in grams over here. Later, while you have completely solved it, you can again convert it into kgs. But for now, they're asking us how much aluminium is required to get 1120 kgs of iron. As per the equation, we know 54 grams was required for 112 grams of iron. Now let's cross multiply it. When we cross multiply it, we are cancelling 112 ones and 112 tens are. We are writing 54, and how many zeros were there over here? There were 4 zeros. 1, 2, 3 and 4. So this particular number can also be written as 540 into 1000. So 1 kg is 1000 grams. So 540 kgs of aluminium is the answer. You can write here 540 kgs of aluminium. Okay, if you look at the sum over there, you need to write an equation also that 540 kgs of aluminium is required to get 1120 kgs of iron. That's all. That was the first problem. Okay, please try it out. Please practice it out. Then further, we will move on to the rest of the two problems given in the textbook over here. Okay.